All right. Good morning, everyone. It's great to be back worshiping with you all. Welcome to our worship service. We want to especially welcome those of you who are new to South Columbia. If you're new and you're here for the first time, welcome. If you are here for the first time, my name is Jim Chung, and I'm the associate pastor here. And I just want to share a little bit about our church with you. Our mission here is to introduce people to Jesus and to help those who already know Jesus to become more like him. And our vision is to follow Jesus Christ through worship, nurture, and outreach. If you want to know more about our church and the different ministries that we have and the different events that we have going on, we invite you to visit our website, which you can find at scbcmd.org. At this time, we don't have a designated time for giving, but we do have an offering box right outside the sanctuary. And if you prefer to give online, if you prefer to give online, you can visit our website, the give page of our website, and that'll tell you all the different ways that you can do that. Let's see. We just went on a mission trip, and everything went amazing. And so we're going to be sharing with you guys at some point in the near future. I'm not exactly sure when it is going to be, but we're going to be sharing with you guys what we did, how everything went, and the implications of what we did and how that'll impact us here. And so hopefully we'll get to do that pretty soon. We do have youth group tonight. It's going to be from 5 to 7, so keep that in mind. And I think that's it. So it's time to greet one another. So if you'll please stand, let's greet one another in the love of Christ. And if you're watching from home, drop us a comment or a chat so that we can greet you too. Thank you.
All right, good morning, South Columbia. Let's begin worship with singing about the love of the Lord.
I will serve the Lord with all my heart, with all my
Heavenly Father, you have called us to love you. You have called us to love one another. And we thank you, Father, for the gift of eternal life that you give through your Son, Jesus. And Jesus, in your word, tells us that he is the bread of life. And it's through him that we are nourished spiritually, and it's through him that we have eternal life. And he tells us in his word that he is the great shepherd. And as the great shepherd, he protects us, he feeds us, he watches over us, and he leads us. And we thank you, Heavenly Father, for that as well. In your word, in the book of Revelation, we find that Jesus is the Alpha and the Omega, that he is eternal, that he is from the beginning to the end. And we give you praise and our thanksgiving, Lord, to you for all that you do for us. And Father, we, during this time, as we remember who you are, let us sing with everything that we have, Lord, praises to your name. And I pray, Lord, that we would be thankful, Father, for all that you give us, Lord. And I pray, Heavenly Father, that the worship that we give you during this time, Lord, would be worthy of your name. And so we thank you for your grace, your presence, your love, and the mercy that you give us, Lord. Pray, Lord, that you would fill us with your Holy Spirit so that we can live to glorify you. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Please continue singing with us as we sing about the worthiness of the praise that we give to our God.
I will praise you
with all of my heart.
you. Please be seated.
Back in January, I had the privilege of meeting Nancy Lauder. And Nancy is the director of the Columbia Pregnancy Center, which is literally right down the road from us. If I wasn't so lazy, I could walk to it. And I was really impressed with their ministry, and I asked Nancy if she would come this morning and take a few moments and share her testimony and tell us a little bit about her ministry. So Nancy, come.
Good morning. I'm very thankful to be here. And as probably all of you are aware, certainly in our nation today, this is a hard subject. It's a very hard subject. So if I may, I'm going to ask that you pray with me. Heavenly Father, I stand here as your disciple. I stand here to do your will. And Father, I just pray that your Spirit would guide my thoughts, would guide my every word. Help me to deliver a message of the compassion and mercy that we long to share with women. I pray this in the name of your precious Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. So I started out as a youth minister. I have an undergraduate degree in family and community development, and then I went on to get a master's of pastoral and spiritual care from Loyola University. And for the first 25 years of my career, I was a youth minister. And I somehow, 6 years ago, landed as the executive director of the Columbia Pregnancy Center, which I feel is still youth ministry, but with a little older population most of the time. But I wanted to share with you, I have always been pro-life, and the Columbia Pregnancy Center is a pro-life organization. So we don't hide that we feel like every life is created with intention and purpose. And we feel like every life should be treated with the greatest of dignity and respect. And from the moment of conception, we believe that a soul was created, and that soul should be welcomed into this world, and that we, the people of this nation and of this congregation, are responsible for these lives. And our mission at the Columbia Pregnancy Center is to make sure that every mother has everything she needs to welcome that life. So as a youth minister, I worked at St. Vincent Pilate High School, which many of you may know because it's very close to here. I also was on staff at St. Mary of the Mills as a youth minister. And my daughter grew up in the church and she did mission trips. I was a youth minister, pastor, and I, you know, my daughter came on many mission trips with me, and she decided in high school that she wanted to be a sister, a nun. She wanted to commit her life to serving God in a religious community. So my husband and I were overjoyed that one of our children would serve God in this very demanding capacity. And it was very hard for us, but when she was 17 years old and graduated high school, I put her on a plane to Argentina to live with the sisters. They're called the Servants of the Lord, and their mother house is in Argentina. And Christy was going to live there for 3 months to kind of discern if this was a life for her. And she came back 3 months later, just overjoyed, and said she was going to go to college. And then after college, she would make her final decision. But she thought she would be a religious. In college, she decided to study abroad in Costa Rica. And she studied there for 6 months. And because she'd had such an amazing trip in Argentina, she convinced me to do a mission trip to Argentina. Argentina is very far away, and they speak Spanish. But we decided, and we had 14 girls sign up to go and live with the sisters for 2 weeks. The sisters ran a home for people with disabilities. They ran an orphanage with 150 children, and they ran a daycare center. So we were going to go and work with them for 2 weeks. So we had all this planned, and Christy had gone on her study abroad trip. And she comes home, and we are set to leave on our mission trip 10 days later. And I wake up one morning, early in the morning at 4 a.m., and she's sitting up in the living room. And she had just gotten back from her study abroad, and we were planning to go on this mission trip. And she said, I said, what are you doing up? And she said, well, I need to talk to you and Dad. And I'm like, okay, I'll get him, you know, because at 4 a.m., when your child says, I need to talk to you, you know it's serious. So I got my husband up, and my daughter said, it's the worst possible news ever. And I said, "You've had an abortion." And she said, "No, but I'm pregnant." Well, imagine the shock, right? This was the girl that had loved the church, taught the youth group ministry. This was just not what our plan was. And certainly working for the church, and it was just not our plan. But I remember that morning, she went back to bed, and I remember going to the grocery store, and I bought her a big bouquet of flowers. And when she woke up, there was a note, and I just said, "Life is always beautiful. Even when it's not planned, it's a beautiful thing." And I didn't know how I was going forward from there, because I honestly felt very humiliated, I guess. You know, if I'm just honest, I loved when my daughter was going to become a nun. My daughter in an unplanned pregnancy in college was not really what I wanted to be talking about. So I said, she said, "So I can't go on the mission trip." And I'm like, "Oh no, you're going on the mission trip. Like, you speak Spanish. I don't speak Spanish. I'm not going to," you know, it was like a 36-hour trip to get there. It was in the hills of San Rafael. So there was this big battle, and I just said, "You have to go. We can't cancel it. You have to go." So she came, and we had 14 girls with us, and on the plane, Christy is getting sick to her stomach every 2 hours, and the girls are all confused, and she finally tells them, and that was very hard for her. And I said, "When we get there, you're going to have to tell the sisters." And she's just, I can't. I cannot. Sister Ophelia Day was her mentor, and she said, "I cannot tell Sister Ophelia that I cannot. I just can't." So I kept saying, "You're just going to have to dig deep, because I think you owe her that." So we went to prayer every day, and Christy kept leaving the prayer service. And finally, about the third day, Sister Ophelia Day comes to me, and she says, "I'm really worried about Christy. She just doesn't seem herself. She keeps leaving the prayer." And I said, "Sister, she's pregnant." And I'm sure that had to be a tremendous shock for this woman who was expecting this young girl to join her in the convent. I'm sure she was more shocked than me. And without a moment's hesitation, Sister Ophelia Day said, "Nancy, the one within knows all and feels all. This is a beautiful gift from God. You need to accept this child with great joy, because this is a blessing from God." And I just said, "You know what, sister? It doesn't feel like joy. It feels like a big mess." And she said, "God brought this life into being, and God has a plan for this life. Embrace it." And she said, which I thought this was very important, at least for me, she said, "Nancy, guilt and shame are of the devil. You will not let that be a part of who you are. You are a child of God, and He has created this life, and He wants you to embrace it." So that is what I bring to the Columbia Pregnancy Center. Every woman in an unplanned pregnancy comes with her own story, often challenges that you and I couldn't even imagine facing. And at the Columbia Pregnancy Center, we work very hard to walk with each woman through her pregnancy and her journey to motherhood. We even do a support group for women. Some women are still with us when their children are 2, 3, 4, 5 years old. Some women come to our support group with 2 or 3 children that they've come. They come because they want a community. They come because they need support. They come because they need diapers. We have material assistance for all of our moms. We have formula, diapers, wipes, clothing, cribs, car seats, everything you can imagine you can get from the Columbia Pregnancy Center. We also offer free pregnancy testing, free sonograms, free STI testing, and treatment. So we also know that, and this always is hard for me to say, because I said we're a pro-life organization, but we respect a woman's right to choose. We do options counseling. We cannot, again, going back to Sister's comments, I cannot lie, manipulate, coerce, or shame anybody. That is not what God would call me to do. I listen to women, and I try to be the presence of love in front of them, and I try to hear their story, and I try to help them know that it's going to be okay. I try to let them know that there's a God that loves them, and that God does provide, and that we would do everything that we can to support them. We have an extensive client resource network with options for daycare, food, clothing, shelter, medical care. We never want someone to abort a baby because they didn't have insurance or they didn't have a place to live. We have resources for all of those things. So that's our mission. And Pastor Steve has let me come today to share our mission with you. And you know, the most important thing we do, we have just this year, we have this mom-to-mom group where I said we have anywhere from 10 to 20 women that come every week. We have it in Spanish and in English. And then this year we started Mom-to-Mom 2.0, which we're doing a Bible study for the women that have been in our support group for a long time, because we know that we can only take them so far on this journey. We know that they need to know who Jesus is, and they need to find a community of faith that can continue to support them and help them grow in their understanding of how loved they are. So we have those four support groups, and we also have a support group called Transforming Your Story, which is for women who have had an abortion. We know that Pew Research tells us that in every church across America, one in three women have experienced abortion, and many have regret and need to hear the healing message and the mercy of God. So we also offer a group called Transforming Your Story that meets every 12 weeks for 10 weeks to help women share their stories in a safe place where they can find healing. So we are very busy over there. We're just a stone's throw. We're right at the corner of Broken Land Parkway and Guilford Road. And I'm hoping that I can talk you into doing, lots of churches will do baby bottle campaigns where we'll pass out baby bottles and we'll ask congregations to fill them up with money, either change or check, or you can even donate online during a baby bottle campaign, but to take the opportunity to be intentional about supporting the women in your community. Almost everybody that we serve comes from the zip code of 21046. We serve a very local community. So we want to help the moms among us that need help. So I thank you very much for your support. Of course, I talked longer than I think I was supposed to, but thank you very much. I appreciate the opportunity, and I'll be outside after the service if anyone would like to speak with me. Thank you.
Thank you, Nancy, for sharing your testimony. Let's pray for Crisis Pregnancy Center before we go to the Lord and before we read the scripture. Father, we thank you for who you are and what you had called each one of us to do. Lord, we thank for the ministry of Crisis Pregnancy Center that does your will right close to our neighborhood. Lord, we thank for those people like Nancy working there diligently, taking your word, supporting women who are in trouble. Lord, as we hear this testimony, as we hear your word, Lord, I pray that you would show us how we could partner with this ministry and be able to be your hands and feet. We ask all these things in your son's name. Amen. The scripture reading is from three books of the Bible. It's listed there: Ephesians, Colossians, and 1 Peter. As we read this word, let's pay attention to how God's word is encouraging to serve him, like communities that are around us. We'll start with Ephesians 2, 8 to 10. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and it is not for yourself, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do the good works which God presented in advance for us to do. Moving on to Colossians. Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart, as working for the Lord, not for human masters, since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. It is the Lord Jesus you are serving. Moving on to 1 Peter. Each of you should use whatever gifts you have received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in these various forms. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for a God who is rich in mercies, who is gracious and abounding in love. Thanks for redeeming us, O Father. Lord, we thank for the word today, which talks us about how to serve you, how to be your lamp and light to the world. Lord, I pray that you would take these ministries that you have given to each one of us, to take the gospel, to be spread to the communities around us. Lord, we thank for the faithful members who are here, who are serving this congregation by supporting each other when there is a loss in family, when there is relationship problem, when there is a physical and spiritual need. Lord, I pray that now our prayer today is that you would give us a heart to expand our ministries, to do different things that would serve and take your word across. Lord, be with the pastor as he brings the message. Lord, I pray that everyone who comes, hears the message, would be transformed and be committed to you. We ask all these things in your son's name. Amen.
For by grace, you've been saved. Not of your own works. It's a gift of God. Now, what will you do? That's the challenge. Please stand with us as we sing, I Will Serve Thee.
Have your Bibles. Let's open again to Ephesians chapter 2. And I appreciate you being here this morning. And as we come to God's Word, I'm going to ask if you will pray with me. Lord, thank you for your love and your grace, and thank you for what you're doing in the lives of people. And this morning, Father, we ask that you would teach us from your Word. Thank you for the truth of Scripture. Thank you that it is your inerrant and infallible word to us, that, Lord, not only can we believe it, but that we can build our entire lives upon its message. Thank you for
the grace you give us. And Lord, I thank you for an opportunity as a community to come together this morning and to worship. And so, Lord, we pray that your Spirit would direct us. Lord, this morning I pray for those families in our church who are grieving the death of loved ones during this last week. We ask for the Holy Spirit to come alongside and to bring assurance and comfort. And we thank you for the wonderful promises of your word, that to know Jesus Christ is to guarantee our presence in heaven with him. Lord, we thank you for the assurance that comes. And so this morning, Lord, we pray for them. We pray for all of us, Lord. Today as we come, we ask that you would speak to us, for we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. If I asked you who or what a Christian is, I wonder how you would respond. Some might simply say, well, a Christian is a follower of Christ. And others might say a Christian is a person who's placed their faith and trust in Jesus as Lord and Savior. Consider this one explanation. A 10-year-old little girl was asked by her classmates, what's it like to be a Christian? And she said, it's like being a pumpkin. God picks you from the patch, brings you in, washes all the dirt off of you, then he cuts open the top and scoops out all the yucky stuff. He removes the seeds of doubt, hate, greed, and then he carves you a new smiling face and puts his light inside of you to shine for all the world to see. Well, there's nothing inherently wrong with any of these definitions, yet they really don't paint the whole picture or tell the whole story. Yes, a Christian is a person who has placed their faith and trust in the redemptive work of Jesus Christ through his death on the cross and his subsequent resurrection. A Christian is trusting in Jesus as Lord and Savior. According to the Bible, though, a Christian has been blessed with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ, has also become a new creation in Christ. Not only has a change occurred in a person's standing or their relationship with God, but through the indwelling presence of God's Spirit, that change is something that happens practically where we begin this process of transformation of becoming like Jesus Christ. Salvation is God's gift. It's not earned or deserved. God demonstrates his love to us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. You've probably heard before that being a Christian means that we have been saved from the penalty of our sin, that we are being saved from the presence of power of sin, and one day we're going to be saved from the presence of sin. But salvation means more than just waiting for heaven. Have you ever heard the criticism about Christians that they're so heavenly minded, they're no earthly use? Salvation means that God has indeed secured our future, but it also means that he has a purpose for you now. And that purpose, simply stated, is to live for him. To trust Christ means to commit your life to him. Becoming a Christian fundamentally means the submission of your will to God's will. And the version of Christianity which says that we can be saved and still cling to our sins but not have any desire to live for Christ, that we can live our lives any way we want to as long as we've made some kind of profession of faith or signed somewhere on a dotted line, may appear attractive and even popular to some folks, but it's simply not true. Following Jesus is not about convenience. It's about taking up a cross. Jesus said, if anyone wishes to come after me, he must deny himself daily and come after me. And that sounds much like a lot deeper commitment than just believing in Jesus. Learning to follow Jesus, learning to be his disciple, means not just trying to deny self, it means learning to die to self. Sometimes the question is raised, well, can a person be a believer in Jesus and not a disciple? And the answer to that question thrusts you into a debate called Lordship Salvation. And in a real quick summary, as some people say that you need to confess Jesus as Lord the minute at salvation. And that if you don't, then you're not saved. And others say, no, we trust Jesus as Savior. And then the understanding of Lordship is something that can happen later in life. Well, let me just put it in my own words. While a person may not fully understand all of the changes and all the ramifications that making Jesus Lord is going to mean when they trust him, to knowingly, let me say that again, to knowingly or willingly take the gift of heaven, to trust Jesus as Savior, and at the same time not make him Lord, doesn't understand biblical salvation. His Lordship is where our life song becomes, I'll say yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. I say yes, Lord, yes. I will trust you and obey. When your spirit speaks to me with my whole heart, I'll agree, and my answer will be yes, Lord, yes. Day by day, following Jesus is learning to say yes, Lord, yes. So this morning, I want us to think about our lives as believers as fundamentally a life of service. To become a Christian means that I am to serve God. And I can imagine someone thinking, here we go again. The pastor is preaching another recruitment sermon about trying to get people to serve on some committee or to take some leadership position in the church. No, that's not what I mean. Because frankly, if we were to grasp what a life of service to God really meant, I don't think getting people to serve in the church would be a problem. Several years ago, I and a fellow pastor had the privilege of going to India, where for a week we taught some classes to some Baptist Indian pastors. And on the way back after our conference, we were in a SUV driving back to the city of Chennai. And I asked Dr. Sam Devinson, the pastor of the Tamil Baptist Church and kind of like the mentor of that ministry there, I said, Dr. Sam, what's the greatest need in your church? And he said, getting people to serve. And I told him he wasn't alone. So whether it's the Tamil Baptist Church in India or our church, or I suspect in most churches, the need for people to serve is a real need. But if we think about life as a service to God, I want us to think, first of all, that service is the appropriate response to God's grace. Prakash read for us just a few moments ago some very familiar verses from Paul's letter. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourself. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, lest anyone should boast. The scripture is very clear. A relationship with Jesus Christ is God's gift. It's not from any human work or any human effort or any attempt. We may not, however, be quite as familiar with verse 10. For we are his workmanship, masterpiece, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. And what we miss in verse 10 is not only a reaffirmation of grace in verses 8 and 9, but a stated purpose for our lives. Some of you may remember, now this is going way back, many, many years ago when our church participated in the 40 days of purpose study. And in one of those studies, it focused on the truth that we're shaped for serving God. Rick Warren wrote in The Purpose-Driven Life, you were put on earth to make a contribution. You weren't just created to consume resources, to eat and breathe and take up space. God designed you to make a difference in your life. While many best-selling books, he says, offer advice on how to get the most out of life, that's not the reason God made you. You were created to add to life on earth, not just take from it. God wants you to give something back. So let me ask you a question. Do you live with an awareness that God has a purpose for your life? And I'm speaking to everyone. You might be a child, an adult, senior adult, a married person, a single person, but do you live today with the awareness that God has a purpose for your life? Now think about that for a second. See, God didn't create us just to sit and soak. He created us to serve. Your creator, your maker, made you with a purpose, and that purpose is tied to your relationship with Jesus. Listen again. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand so that we walk in them. We are his workmanship. And the Greek word, which is only used, by the way, twice in the New Testament, is where we get our English word poem. But it can mean any work of art. A statue, a song, architecture, a poem, or a painting. It conveys the idea of something that has been artfully and beautifully created. You are God's work of art, not a piece of work. You're a work of art. You are his masterpiece, his poem. You are a unique, one-of-a-kind, original creation, and perhaps in a little less refined language, God don't make no junk. Notice that the Bible says that you were created for good works, which means that God didn't call you just to be, but to do. There are things for us to do, activities in which to engage, a ministry and service to perform. And the contrast in this passage is powerful. Good works do not, in fact, cannot save us, but as people who have been saved, we are to do good works. One comparison suggests that works are to salvation what thunder is to lightning, an inevitable result. Notice that God has prepared these good works beforehand so that we should walk in them. Now, Paul doesn't provide a list of good works to which he's referring. And while he's speaking to the church collectively, there is also an application for each of us individually. Good works are the expression of our relationship with Jesus. It is good works that characterize the life of the believer. And the Bible says that God prepared them ahead of time so that we should walk in them. And the idea of walking in them is so that we'll fall into them. They're already there. We just have to discover them. So what kinds of good works? Well, they're the good works in Christ. They are the works that grow out of our relationship with him, the works that are initiated and energized by the Spirit of God. Vine, in his commentary, said it signifies every kind of activity undertaken for the name of Christ. Everything so undertaken is a means of fruitfulness, and the operating power is the indwelling Holy Spirit, on whom the believer is entirely dependent. God has prepared a good work for you to do, a service for you to do. He has a ministry that he's laid out for you, and all of this grows out of God's purpose in your life. And I might just speculate that perhaps this good work that God has for you is not necessarily the same thing as your vocation. Have you considered that what you do to pay the bills, put food on the table, and keep the electricity on is not your defining purpose in life? I'm not advocating quitting your job, sitting around and waiting for God to clearly communicate his purpose. But I am challenging you with the possibility that God has something far greater in mind, something far more eternally significant than just what takes place at the workplace. God made you to serve him. He calls you to serve him. He's even gifted you to serve him. And sometimes at this point, people say, I know he's not talking about me, but I am. God wants to use you. He created you to be used by him. He's already prepared works for you. It's kind of a cliche, but I absolutely believe this is true, that God's not so much concerned about our ability as he is our availability. There's a story about a missionary in a remote, poverty-stricken area in West Africa. He appealed to support for Christians' work throughout the area and encouraged those present to give what they could for the construction of a building which would serve not only as a clinic but as a place of worship. Approximately 2 hours later, after the worship service, a young woman came to the missionary and presented him with $40 to be used for the building project. The missionary was stunned. Where on earth, he thought, did this woman come up with such a large amount of money in a region affected by painfully forbidding circumstances? Confounded, he posed the question as politely as he knew how and was informed that she had gone to a wealthy planter and sold herself into his service for the rest of her life. Why? It was her way of giving herself into the service of Jesus Christ, not partially, but totally. Now that sounds like a pretty radical price to pay, doesn't it? However, if you think such a measure of commitment is radical, Think again about God's grace in saving you. And understand that a lifetime commitment of service is an appropriate response. Because all of life ought to be a continual outpouring because of His grace. The other scripture that Prakash read this morning came from Colossians. Whatever you do, do your work heartily as for the Lord rather than for men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the reward of inheritance. Now listen to this last sentence. It is the Lord Jesus Christ whom you serve. Service is an appropriate response to God's grace. Service assists to edify the body of Christ. You also heard this morning, as each one has received a special gift, employ it in serving one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. And here the word for service is the word from which we get our word deacon, which literally means to wait on tables. The context of Peter's words, along with what Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians and the book of Romans, is the body of Christ. Our lives should be dedicated in the service of Jesus, and while serving Jesus and serving the church are not identical, they are not mutually exclusive. I will say that serving or ministering to Jesus isn't just limited to the church, but it is vitally connected to the church. And while there are ministries, you heard about one this morning, and opportunities to serve Jesus outside the local church, it is the local church, the body of Christ, that is the primary means by which we do ministry in this world. He has called you to serve His church. There was a minister who was approached by a man who expressed a desire to become a member of his congregation. The man said, though, that he really was rather busy and wouldn't have time to volunteer. I don't want to be called on for any services such as committee work, teaching a class, or singing in the choir. Then, too, don't expect me for worship very often. The minister thought for a moment. He said, I think you have the wrong church. The church you're looking for is three blocks down the street. The man followed the preacher's directions, and he came to an abandoned, boarded-up, closed-up church building that had gone dead, out of business. I'm going to be blunt. If you're a member of this church family, then you should be serving this church somehow. The question is, are you? And if not, why not? See, not only are we supposed to serve, but you need to serve, not only for the sake of, I think, obedience, but for the health of the body. And if you think that this is just another typical preacher manipulation to create some guilt or coercion, I want you to listen to the word of the Apostle Paul from the Common English Bible translation. He gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers. His purpose was to equip God's people for the work of serving and building up the body of Christ until we all reach the unity of faith and knowledge of God's Son. God's goal is for us to become mature adults, to be fully grown, measured up by the standard of the fullness of Christ. As a result, we aren't to be infants any longer who can be tossed and blown around by every wind that comes from teaching and deceitful scheming and the tricks people play to deliberately mislead others. Instead, by speaking the truth in love, let's grow in every way into Christ, who is the head. The whole body grows from Him and is joined and held together by all supporting ligaments. The body makes itself grow in that it builds itself up in love as each one does his part. As each one does his part. The problem is that when some parts are not doing their part, the whole body suffers. And that happens way too often in churches, where most of the work is done by a comparative few who are on the edge, if they've not already burned out, trying to do their part and somebody else's part also. I came across this short kind of tongue-in-cheek piece. There is a story about four people named Everybody, Somebody, Anybody, and Nobody. There was an important job to do, and everybody was asked to do it. Everybody was sure somebody would do it. Anybody could have done it, but nobody did it. Somebody got angry because it was everybody's job. Everybody thought anybody would do it, but nobody realized that everybody wouldn't do it, and it ended up that everybody blamed somebody when nobody did what anybody could have done. Just kind of have to think about that one for a while. Scott Libby, a traveling minister for a Presbyterian church in Iowa, was to preach for a vacationing minister one Sunday, so he decided that he would get to the church early and become familiar with the order of service and the layout. And as he's going down the hall, he passed the nursery area where he saw one child there all by himself. He paused for a moment, and the child said, "Hi, my name's Tommy." And Dr. Libby said, "Well, my name's Scott." Tommy said, "I'm all by myself in this big room." And Dr. Libby repeated, "So you're all by yourself in this big room?" "Yes," said Tommy, "and I'm lonesome." "Well, I'm sure somebody will come shortly and be with you, Tommy." And with this, Tommy pulled up to his full stature, looked Dr. Scott in the eye and said, "What about you?" "What about you? What about me? What about us?" As each one has received a special gift, employing it in serving one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. A couple of weeks ago, we looked at the biblical metaphor of the church, which compared the church to a human body. And the contrast of that metaphor was in the context of spiritual gifts, God-given abilities for service. In that 12th chapter of 1 Corinthians, Paul says, "Now there are a variety of gifts, but the same Spirit, and there are a variety of ministries, but the same Lord, and there are a variety of effects, but the same God who works all things in all persons. But to each one is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good." Notice, by the way, that the entire Godhead is connected in the distribution of spiritual gifts, of which there is tremendous variety. There's a variety of gifts, a variety of ministries in which those gifts can be used, and a variety of results that can result from the ministries in which those gifts are used. I told a friend one day that I had no idea what the possible combination of those three factors could be, and he answered, "Oh, it's easy. It would be spiritual gifts to the third power." I like that answer. The truth is, as we looked at this, nobody has all the spiritual gifts, but no believer is without a gift. God is the one who composes the body, so there are no unnecessary or unheeded gifts. Maybe you know what your spiritual gift is, maybe you don't. Maybe you're thinking, "I'd like to serve, but I don't know how to serve." Well, you don't have to be a theologian or a scholar to serve Jesus. You don't have to have a world of amazing talent. What you need, though, is a servant heart and a willingness to commit. Let me tell you that if you know how to sit in a rocking chair and rock a baby, if you know how to love on a toddler, you can make a big difference in the lives of some people and a huge encouragement for some people in this church family. See, if we're willing to do our part, we'll help you find how to do it. One person wrote, "There's a purpose for you being here. You are meant to answer something, solve something, provide something, lead something, discover something, compose something, write something, say something, translate something, interpret something, sing something, create something, teach something, preach something, bear something, overcome something, and in doing so, you improve the lives of others under the power of God for the glory of God." Service is the appropriate response to God's grace. Service assists to edify the body of Christ. Just one more thought. Service accentuates our worship of God. When I was preparing this message, I discovered that in the New Testament, there are basically three, there might be more, but I found three words that are translated by our English word serve. Now, I already mentioned the word, which means to wait on tables. And in the verse from Colossians, where Paul says, "It is the Lord Jesus Christ whom you serve," the word means to be a slave. The Apostle Paul uses the third word when he wrote, "For God, whom I serve in the Spirit, in the preaching of the gospel of his Son, is my witness, how unceasingly I mention of you." And it's interesting that this word for serve is the same word that is used in Romans chapter 12, verse 1. And it's a word that is translated worship, or carrying out the religious duties of worship. You remember that verse in Romans 12, 1? "Therefore, I urge you, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your body a living and holy sacrifice, acceptable to God, which is your spiritual service of worship." When God brought the Hebrew people out of slavery in Egypt, he brought them to a mountain where he gave them his law, part of what we call the Ten Commandments. And if you remember, the first two commandments were this: "I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol or any likeness of what is in heaven above or in the earth beneath or in the water under the earth. You shall not worship them, now listen, or serve them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of our fathers on the of the children on the third, fourth generations of those who hate me. You shall not worship them or serve them. A couple years ago, we went through the Gospel of John, and back then I mentioned I wondered, well, how did idolaters serve their gods? It would seem apparent that they trusted in them, they had faith in them, hoped in them. They believed that maybe by believing that the idols had some sort of power, whether it was to make it rain or bring a good crop or to make their family fertile. But how did they serve them? Did they sign up for the idol fellowship committee? I don't think so. Probably not. But they prayed to them. And the more gruesome way they served him was in all kinds of perverted rituals of worship that involved things that I don't even want to mention this morning. And the reason they did it is because they were terrified of the consequences of disobeying, choosing to put themselves through personal danger and physical abuse to appease any anger, to ensure that they might have an easy life. But it didn't work because their gods weren't real. I can't help but think, if people were willing to make those kinds of commitments and sacrifices to gods that weren't real, how should the believer in Jesus Christ serve the real God who is real? We serve him as a living sacrifice, dead to self but alive to God. Every aspect of our life as a believer is to be yielded to God. This is how we serve God. It is how we worship him, by giving up our lives to him so he can work in us both to do his will and to work for his good pleasure. Bill Booknight wrote about a true story that was told to him by Dr. Edward Bauman of Washington, D.C. A boy named Tony was born into a family in a Midwestern state. He was blind at birth. He suffered from an extremely rare eye problem for which there, at the time, was no known cure. When the little fellow was about 7 years old, his doctor read in the New England Journal of Medicine a new surgical procedure that showed some promise for this particular problem. A young surgeon at Massachusetts General Hospital in Boston had developed it. The local doctor and the surgeon began communicating. The boy's full medical record was sent, and a decision was made to try surgery. Since Tony's family couldn't afford the expenses that were involved, local churches and civic clubs helped out. Tony had a favorite teddy bear, which he kept with him almost all the time, but that teddy bear was beginning to show signs of wear. One eye was missing, one ear was chewed off, and through several holes the stuffing was oozing out. Tony's mother told him they were going to buy him a new teddy bear when he took the trip to Boston, but Tony rejected that offer in no uncertain terms. What good is a new teddy bear when you have an old, familiar, friendly one already broken in? So the old teddy bear went to Boston and remained close to Tony through all the medical procedures leading up to surgery, x-rays, tests, consultations. In fact, the boy and the teddy bear were not separated until the anesthesia was applied. Throughout the whole period, the boy and this young surgeon were becoming great friends. In fact, the surgeon was almost excited for the family about the possibilities of surgery as they were. There was just a really good chemistry and friendship and trust between this young doctor and Tony. And when the surgery was completed, Tony was heavily bandaged and remained quite still for a number of days. That's kind of hard for a seven-year-old. But each day, the surgeon was in and out of the room encouraging him. Finally, the day came for removing the bandages, and for the first time in the 7 years of his life, this little boy could see. Though the vision was blurred at first, it gradually clarified. And for the first time, Tony looked into the faces of his parents, saw a tree, saw a sunset. The young surgeon was almost literally jumping up and down for joy. Before long, it was time for Tony to be discharged and to go home. The surgeon had actually been dreading this day because the two of them had become such good friends. On that final morning, the surgeon signed the necessary discharge papers. He gave Tony a big hug and said, "Now listen, I own stock in you. I expect to get letters from you regularly. Do you understand? And then Tony did something totally unexpected. He said to a surgeon friend, here, I want you to have this. And he handed him his teddy bear. The surgeon's first impulse was to say, oh, no, I can't separate you two good friends. But then something stopped him. And with a flash of sensitive genius, the surgeon understood what Tony was trying to do. He wanted to give his dear surgeon friend the most precious gift at his disposal, because so full was his heart with love. The wise surgeon accepted the teddy bear with a hug and a thank you, assuring Tony that he would take mighty good care of his friend. Do you know that for over 10 years, that teddy bear sat in a glass case on the 10th floor of Massachusetts General Hospital? One eye missing, one ear half chewed off, stuffing coming out of holes. And in front of the teddy bear was the surgeon's professional name card. And just beneath his name, he had written this caption. This is the highest fee that I have ever received for professional services rendered. A little boy had given the most precious item he had out of a love-filled heart. Book Knight then adds, 2,000 years ago, a gracious God, with a heart filled of love, looked upon our sin-marred, tear-stained world. Had you and I been in charge, we might have destroyed the whole mess and started over. But God's great heart was too full of love to allow that, so he gave the most precious gift of his disposal, he gave himself. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Confronted by such an awesome gift, our only fitting response is to fall on our knees and enthrone the living Christ as our personal King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And I would add that such a response also demands that we serve him with a continual outpouring of gratitude. We serve him because service is the appropriate response to God's grace. Service assists to edify the body of Christ, and service accentuates our worship of the Lord. Let's pray together. Lord, we are so grateful for you and to you for who you are and what you do. And Father, we thank you, and we pray that you would continually fill our hearts with a spirit of gratitude, and as a result, Lord, that we might serve you however and wherever that might be. Lord, that all of our life might be an expression of service to you. Lord, we thank you for your faithfulness and your goodness. And Lord, protect us from those times in life where we're not grateful. Forgive us, Father, for when we think we're entitled, where, Lord, we battle the sin of selfishness or self-interest. And Lord, may we learn how to live, and I pray that for myself and for all of us, that each day that we might awaken with an awareness of, Lord, how can I serve you today? What, Lord, do you desire from my life today? Not because, Lord, we do it out of fear and not out of compulsion, but out of gratitude, just to be reminded of how much you loved us. You loved us so much that you sent Jesus to die on a cross for our sins. Lord, this morning as we conclude our gathering together, if there's anyone here or anyone joining us online who has never made that decision to put their faith and trust in Christ, then I pray that today would be the day, this would be the time, now would be the moment where they would make that decision. For I pray it in Jesus' name, amen. We're going to ask our team to come up and lead us in a closing song. And this morning, if you're here and you have never made that decision to trust Christ, and you want to talk to someone about how to make that or what that means, then as we're singing, I'm going to ask you to slip out of your chair and I'll meet you here at the front. We'll have someone open God's word to you and show you how you can make that decision. If you're watching us online and that's a decision you want to make, please let us know right now and we'll respond as soon as possible. If there's any other way that we can encourage you spiritually this morning, we ask that you come if it's a decision that you want to share publicly. We're going to sing again what we sung just a moment ago, I Will Serve Thee. Let's sing this as our commitment to the Lord this morning. Let's stand together and sing. grateful to you this morning for your love. Lord, I want to thank you for every person who's here today and every person who's joined us this morning online. And Lord, as we get ready to go back out into this week, I pray that you would, Lord, help us to fall into those good works that you've already prepared for us. Lord, teach us how to serve you. We also pray for opportunities to have gospel conversations with people. And Lord, I would add my prayer this morning for the Columbia Pregnancy Center. And thank you for Nancy and her staff and their work. And Lord, we pray this morning that you would empower them as they continue to serve here and ministering, Lord, to young women and young men who really need to hear the good news of Jesus Christ. Thank you for your love. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Thank you for being here this morning.